Coming up on the show, we share our top 5 tips for successfully accelerating information protection inside of your organization. And we show you key technology updates for Azure Information Protection, such as scope policies for scaling up and personalizing the default information classification labels for specialized teams, and preparing for the next generation of rights management protected secure email. I'm joined once more by Dan Plastina, our resident expert in information protection. Dan, welcome to the show.
Hey, Simon. Good to be back.
So information protection and governance is a topic that we've covered quite a lot on Microsoft Mechanics. And I know that it's a lot easier said than done. For those folks out there who may be a little bit less familiar with Azure Information Protection, though, can you share a little bit about what your team has been doing to ease the burden?
Absolutely. Our whole focus with information protection, really in providing an answer to this data loss challenge, is simplicity. We're making protecting information a whole lot easier. Data lifecycle is anchored in classification and labeling, and that'll be our focus today.
Yeah.
The goal really is to make it trivial for a user to classify information with a single click. The goal then is to make sure that we're not impacting their productivity. Labeling and protection are then taken care of indirectly as part of that classification phase.
So beyond making the task simple, people are obviously central to the successful adoption of information protection. Let's move on and start with your first tip.
Well, the success of an information protection deployment starts with having the right set of initial labels. So our first tip is thus to pick standardized and approachable labels.
So that's a really interesting choice of words. I get that approachable probably means that we really need the users to be able to understand those labels so that they can take the lead on assessing the sensitivity of the information that they create, consume, and share, since they're probably the best place to do so. But what do you mean by standardized?
You know, it's a lot harder to pick good names than one would assume. I spent the last year of my life helping people pick terms or convincing them to change what they already have picked. You know, users are just not data geeks. So terms like medium business impact or level C3, they don't do much to win over a normal user population, really, unless they're part of a secret agency or something. What we want to do is to come up with common language that has the user connect with the terms and get a sense of that sensitivity progression. We want them to succeed with well-tested words, words that they can easily relate to.
That makes sense, but the space is really nuanced. I presume we've got like a set of tried and tested labels that are maybe automatically configured now in the tenants?
Yeah, we sure do. We recommend 5 labels be used. These have held up to usability tests we've done and reviews with a lot of customers. Mm-hmm. So what we're doing right now is picking those defaults that we will set for all new customers. You want me to show them to you?
Yeah, that'd be great.
So let's just take a peek at a normal document. So here what I have is a Word doc. When you create new Word documents, they'll default to general. I'll explain that a bit more later. And then you have a choice of labels if you want to change it. Personal here, if I hover over it, will tell you it's non-business data for personal use only. Public, this is content that's been vetted or approved for public consumption, like a brochure for a team. General, this is an example, the perfect example really, of how tricky this could be. General is really business internal, but internal creates ambiguity in modern organizations because a lot of folks are now outsourced. So for example, if a company were to outsource legal, is sharing to your lawyers internal or not? And so that's where the term general comes in. So this is a great new term that we use. Confidential is a term that really is well understood and used internationally. So there's no problem there. And that's where we start applying protection. Highly confidential reuses the term confidential for a reason. It's very clear that it's more confidential than confidential. In some parts of the world and some organizations have used the term restricted. And confidential, restricted, confidential, it's not quite clear. Mm-hmm. And we see that in Europe, often people will flip that around. So using highly confidential as the more sensitive one, confidential as the least, you don't have that problem with the ordering.
Okay, it's nuanced, but it seems simple enough when you describe it like that. Do all of these labels apply to everyone in every single department and every job role?
You know, yes, everyone should have this common set of global labels. No exceptions. You want to train people once on one set, and that's it. Mm-hmm. With this done, you're then able to teach your IT systems to to look for those labels universally across all of your trust sensor fabric. So for example, I'll show you an MCAS admin console. And here you can see that classification label input equals confidential. Here we filtered content using MCAS, which is Microsoft Cloud App Security, or CASB. And it blocked certain data of confidential or above from going to the cloud. And so that's an example of that.
So that was Cloud App Security. And I think we're also working with other DLP vendors, right?
Yes, we're working with all the large DLP vendors in this space.
Now, if you're in a large organization, though, I'd imagine that some users may want to narrow down the sharing of more restrictive types of data.
Absolutely. For those users, we've created a secondary concept we call sublabels. This is really tip number two, is to create sublabels for key departments. The idea here is the ability to narrow down who can access data lets you implement the often required ethical walls that naturally exist in larger or regulated organization. Let's take a look at what we've set up here for our company, and you'll get a good sense for that.
Sure.
So here I have a document that is quite a bit more sensitive than the blank one I showed earlier. Mm-hmm. And general is not appropriate as the default here. So if I click on confidential, you'll see here a list of other options. These we'll talk about how they get configured later. But you'll see here that I've got one for legal, one for finance, and the same thing here exists on the highly confidential side, including one called Project Samos. Again, I'll touch on that in a minute. So I could just click confidential finance, and the act of protecting this document will make this document sensitive and scoped only to the finance team.
And this is going to vary by organization size and the data that's most important, most sensitive to your business.
Absolutely. Typically, the larger the organization, the more sublabels you require. You do not need to change the global labels. In fact, you don't want to change them. This is your, hey, my team is special pressure valve. So you can acknowledge the teams are special, but start with the least possible number of these. Generally, you'd want to work with each of the business divisions, get a sense for what their data protection requirements are, mm-hmm. and their ambitions. Those may differ. Together, you'll come up with a model where you're going to try to keep things as similar as possible for all of these groups. But you will find some conflicting needs. I can give you two common examples we see quite a bit. For finance employees, generally the default classification, that may need to be confidential because day to day they deal with a lot of sensitive stuff. Now, just because financial people or legal or HR deal with sensitive stuff, that doesn't mean you want to do that for everybody in your company. So that's an exception. Another great example is a tented project. These are projects where sometimes only some people should know of the project, let alone access the data. This is common in merger and acquisition work. Legal teams have a lot of issues like that as well. For example, when I purchased the Secure Islands company last year, we codenamed it Project Samos, and I would have created a label just for Project Samos, like the one I just showed you.
Very cool.
Now, only I should see that. And you don't really want to let other people see it because the curiosity would cause people to talk, mm-hmm. and people talking would cause data to leak. So really, this brings us to tip three, being able to use scope policies to control these specialized behaviors.
And you've recently released scope policies. Can we dive into those for a little bit?
Yeah, absolutely. Let's go take a peek at the admin console. So here in the admin console, you'll see one important shift from last time. The first screen we see here has now scoped policy sets. You'll see global, which is the default policy for all users. Mm-hmm. And I've created two new ones to showcase what we've done today. Now, you can click on this little add new policy button here to create new ones. We're just gonna stick with what I've done for the demo. So, looking at global, you can see the core labels that are visible to users. Personal, public, general, confidential, highly confidential. And you also see some of the items that showed up when we were in Word. Mm-hmm. So this is part of the global set available to everybody. And it requires a default, which is on, and it's general. I also require justification here. So if someone lowers the policy, they have to justify doing so.
That makes sense.
Now, let's go take a look at Project Samos. The Project Samos policy is similar. And this is where here you could see that Project Samos is a new sublabel. You can see it here. It says Project Samos in the policy column. And if you want to add new ones like these, you would just go click on here and say add sublabel. Mm-hmm. So you can add new ones. This particular one, you can see, select which users groups get this policy. Project Samos Users is a security group. I'm a member of it. I see that label. If you're not a member of it, you would not see that label. Now, let's go look at the management one. Same thing. The management one is for managers. So anyone's a manager in this group sees these labels. And here what I've done is under confidential and highly confidential, I've created human resources, legal, and finance. And so here I have the ability to also mandate behavior. So on a default labeling, general is this. If I want to change it for the managers, I could say confidential full-time employees. And if I push this out, everybody who's in a manager group would get a different default than the global template of general.
So the idea here is that everyone gets global unless there's a specific override for them.
Yes, precisely.
So what I like about tip three is that scope policies mean that we still consistently label things and users just see the labels that they need and IT can customize the actions that correlate to the label.
Yeah, that is exactly right. You know, early on I said we had made this a whole lot easier. These tips will really make deployment of this a lot easier in your company.
This is great, but how does IT get to the point where all of their data is being classified? Surely we can't expect users to just go along classifying everything.
Yes, this is in fact tip number four, where I suggest you strongly focus on encouraging the right behavior. Let's review the four approaches to getting data classified. Automatic, recommended, reclassification, and user set. Automatic is all about doing something via rules. If you go too far and have a reliance on automatic, you're not going to achieve nirvana there. They don't put too many eggs in that basket. Mm-hmm. On the other extreme, you've got user set policy. This is where you expect your users to classify everything manually. Again, don't hold your breath for that turning out perfectly. Really, where there's magic is in the middle. The combination of recommended and reclassification really can do wonders. So this is where you pick a default or a couple of defaults if you're using the scope policies capability. And from there, let the user change or reclassify things. Mm-hmm. Add a little bit of automation in the form of a recommendation, and now you hit the sweet spot. So let me show you how recommendation works. Mm-hmm. I'm back in the document we used earlier, and I had classified manually. We've set up some triggers on the server side, and if I type in, say, confidential legal, when I go to save this document, a recommendation came up and it says confidential legal. I have the right to change now. I can type in something else or pick something else. If I change this to be, say, confidential HR, you'll see the recommendation changed to HR. So here, the user was offered a choice and I can accept it or override it.
So Dan, what else can IT do to encourage users to have the right behavior?
Yeah, thus far we've focused a lot on getting classification right. You can be up and running in a fraction of the time with these tips. Mm-hmm. Deployments are really easy to control. You set up your global policy, and then you deploy the add-ins to the endpoints you want to manage. So you can get going with that. That said, let's change gears here and focus on securing email, mm-hmm. the other half of the problem. So tip five is about safeguarding email communications. Office 365 users will simply send email the way they do today. The users with Outlook will continue to have a great native experience, and those using any other identity or any other mail client will now get a great experience as well. And so this is so much easier to show, so why don't I just walk you through what it looks like.
Let's do that.
So here I'm in Outlook. I have a protected message right next to an unprotected message, and going between them is really straightforward. Yeah. This one here says do not forward. This will carry through to the others. Here, I'm in Outlook.com, and I'm looking at the same do not forward email message, also encrypted, seamless. I was able to just log into Outlook and read these messages. Mm-hmm. Let's take a peek at a different client. Now, in this case, I'm in a Google mail client in a Chrome browser, and I have that same protected email message. But let me show you what it looks like today first. This is a message that's encrypted, where we tell you to buy Office to read it. Not a great customer experience, and this is why email gateways exist today. Mm-hmm. Moving forward, reading that sensitive email message is just a matter of saying, click here to read. And what we do is we then invite you to prove who you are before we decrypt it.
Okay.
Now, sign in with Google. We just do single sign-on, exactly the same way the Live ID demo looked. Mm-hmm. Let's try the single use code. So here what I've done is I've been invited to go to my inbox to prove that I am that person. So I'll go back to my inbox, see that a passcode has arrived. I'm going to copy this passcode, and I will paste it in here. When I hit continue, the customer who sent me this data, they're setting up a mail environment that lets me read the encrypted message. Now I can read it, reply, interact with you. You don't know that I'm using this read online experience, and I don't really care what clients you have. So this just makes everything work.
And it's great because it doesn't interrupt the regular mail flow that anybody is actually used to using.
Right, that was the core design goal. Again, we'll be rolling this out in coming months, so you want to get ready for it. The way you want to think about this is if you have an existing solution, figure out how you're going to unwind that. Mm-hmm. If you don't have anything, figure out how it is you're going to get a rapid deployment with select teams in your company. This will be a game changer in terms of sending secure email.
That was great. Thanks, Dan. And very useful explanation. Hopefully these top five tips that we've gone through are going to help you really kickstart information protection inside your organization. How can these folks learn more?
If you want to learn more tips on information protection, we encourage you to follow our blog series at the link below. You can also contact our alias for specific answers to your questions.
Thanks, Dan, and thank you for watching Microsoft Mechanics. Don't forget to keep tuning in for the latest in tech updates. We'll see you next time.